Dear friends and family in Christ, our Lord has shown us his gracious love for us in sending his Son Jesus to die on the cross. May this grace fill your hearts. May his love be in all your actions this day and every day. Please join me in prayer. Lord, Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for sending forth your Son, Christ Jesus. We thank you for his sacrifice on the cross, for his willingness to die for us, for the forgiveness you now give to us. We pray that each day we would lead lives that not only receive this love that you show to us, but also reflect it to others. This we pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior, our Lord. Amen. I don't know about you, but I like to collect things. It doesn't have to be anything specific, but I like to collect things. In fact, one of the things, and maybe you all remember this, but back before they had computers or tablets in classrooms, we used to have to take notes by hand. Most of you remember that? Going to school and having to take notes. There were shorthand notes you would take. Well, I never learned the shorthand, so I had copious notes. In fact, I had boxes of notes from high school. All 4 years, I kept them. We moved to seminary with them. We moved from seminary to here with them. So that, if you do the math, we had them for 8 years. You can ask Carla, in 8 years, how many times I opened up those notes. That collection of notes that I had taken in high school when I went to trigonometry class, how beneficial it must have been. She made me throw them away when we moved here. None of you blame her. Well, we all like to collect things, don't we? And it is good to have certain things we collect. But there's also a danger when we get a little overboard. Maybe some of you have heard about the disorder called compulsive hoarding. Have you heard that before, compulsive hoarding? There was a show on A&E called Hoarders. They would literally go around to people's homes throughout the United States who would fill their entire houses with stuff, with things. There wouldn't be space for them to sleep in their bed, to eat at their dinner tables. There wouldn't be space for them to hardly walk around to get to the restroom. And the worst one that they showed, the person not only collected stuff, they collected their trash as well. Throughout their house, they had bags of trash. Okay, well, the show Hoarders tried to lead these people to get away from that. Some stuff is good, but holding on to stuff can be bad. Now, many of you, I don't think, would fall into that compulsive hoarding category. I don't think so, anyway. At least not when it comes to stuff. But what about compulsive hoarding of hurts? Instead of objects, of offenses. We live in a sinful world. A world where we see the hurts and pains. Not only other people's hurts and pains, our own hurts and pains. And a lot of times when people hurt us, it's hard for us to forgive them. We hoard those things that people do. We brood about them. We wrestle with them. We let them percolate and boil inside of us. Sometimes they go on boiling silently. Sometimes we explode. Oftentimes we fail to reflect that while other people hurt us, we also hurt others as well. In fact, we rarely think of that because we usually are so caught up in what has been done to us. The offense that's been caused to us, that we rarely reflect back on the way we've lived our lives, the hurts that we have caused others. We look at our lives, and we don't think about the fact that we've done things that have cut people to the heart, even close friends and family. We look at our lives, and we justify ourselves. We say things like, it's okay because I was just sharing my true opinion. I was sharing my thoughts. I was sharing my heart. So it must be all right. Taking for granted other people's feelings. But then, when things get turned around, when someone hurts us, we hold on to it. Maybe if someone hurts us a couple times, maybe 3 times we're ready to forgive, but after that, we don't want to be taken advantage of. We don't want to be seen as weak, so we hold on to those grudges, to that anger. And isn't that where Peter's question came from for today? Isn't that why Peter was asking the question that he did of Jesus? Peter came up and said to Jesus, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as 7 times? Peter wasn't asking that from a position of grace. Well, maybe a small one. He knew that in Jewish tradition that they theorized if someone sinned against you 3 times, the same sin, that after the 3rd time, it proved they were unrepentant, so therefore you could limit forgiveness. So maybe he saw a small image of grace there seven times, or maybe he thought of Proverbs, Solomon's words in Proverbs, where Solomon said, "For the righteous falls seven times and rises again." And he thought maybe a righteous person could sin against him and fall seven times, but after that, no further forgiveness. Peter was content to limit his forgiveness. He was content to hold grudges, to hold things against others. He was not expecting Jesus' response to him, was he? As Jesus responded to him, he said, "I do not say to you seven times, but 77 times." Or other translations will say 70 times seven. But we truly know Jesus didn't just mean 77 or even 490. He used that to say countless times. Jesus told Peter, he tells us that we are to forgive countless times. We are not to keep a record of how many sins have been committed against us, 1 Corinthians 13, but we are to forgive each and every time. Strong words, isn't it? Many of us, like Peter, were content to limit that forgiveness. Maybe we can forgive seven times. 77, maybe that's a little much. But to keep forgiving, to keep letting go, boy, that's hard for us, isn't it? We know the hurts that we felt, the pain that people have inflicted upon us. We know the offenses that people, whether intentionally or unintentionally, have given to us. And it's hard to let go. It really is. We don't like to think about it, but Jesus takes us a step further as we reflect on that forgiveness, question of forgiveness. He makes things abundantly clear. He has us look at this parable, a parable where he shows the beautiful forgiveness of God, that grace that is abundant and the Lord lavishes upon us. The master, 10,000 talents, something that he could have never paid back in six lifetimes. And our master, our Lord, forgives us for our failures to worship him, for our failures to trust him, for our failures to stand up for him, for our failures to follow his law, for our failures to live as his people, for our failures to have him as the center of our lives, for our failures to profess his name wherever we are. He doesn't give us what we deserve. He gives us forgiveness. He gives us his grace. And then he juxtaposes that. Jesus juxtaposes that with us then. These greatly forgiven people of God. How do we respond? We withhold forgiveness. We look at our neighbor, our friend, our family member. And instead of forgiving, we have them beaten, thrown in jail. Maybe not literally. But certainly they take a beating in our minds. Maybe even in our conversations, and certainly in our hearts. But we don't like to think about that, do we? Because it forces us to look at who we are as sinners. It forces us to take a look inside and realize just how ungrateful we have been for God's love to us. Now, we might have our justifications, but those justifications fall apart in the face of God's forgiveness. That being said, what are you holding on to? What in your life are you struggling to forgive? Is it an anger towards a spouse who turned out not to be Mr. Right or Mrs. Right, less than perfect? Is it anger towards a child who forgot to call you on your birthday, or a parent who never made it to your baseball games, soccer games? Is it frustration with the way things have gone with your family as you've been faithful to what God has told you, struggling with stewardship, struggling with making ends meet? Or is your anger with God? Angry that you've lost your child. It doesn't have to be a physical loss. Maybe it's the separation that animosity brings, that anger brings, that fighting brings. Maybe it's anger at God, for as you witnessed your sister day after day, year after year, abused by her husband as he took out his anger and depression. Maybe your anger is at God because as you look at these golden years of life, you realize that they're anything but golden, or if they are, they're tarnished gold. You've lost those you love. You find yourself hurting physically more and more each day, struggling to get out of bed, struggling to move, doing those things that you want to do. Whether your anger's at God or at another person, our Lord Jesus invites us to let it go. For His sake, to let go of it. To stop holding on to it. To stop clutching it close to our chest. To stop brooding over it. To stop percolating on it. Because what it is doing is destroying our relationships. Not merely with one another, but also with God. When we hold those grudges, when we do not let go of things, it drives a wedge between us and our Heavenly Father. You may not think of it as destructive, but really, truly, when you get back to it, where does that unforgiveness come from? A lack of full trust in God. A lack of confidence that God will care for you, that He will do what He has promised to do, to bring all things to the good of those who love Him. And that is where it comes from. And that is what it does, is it is destructive to us. In fact, the more you hold on to things, the longer you hold on to those angers, to those frustrations, those offenses, it hardens your heart. And you all know people who you have seen with hard hearts. Maybe at one time they were friendly and gentle and kind, but as they've held on to their anger and grudges and their judgments and their offenses, their hearts have grown harder. Hardened towards others and even hardened towards God. Questioning Him. See, that unforgiveness, it's not just a problem between one another, but also us and God. When Jesus invited us in the Lord's Prayer to pray, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us," He wasn't saying that God's forgiveness was conditional on us. Thanks be to God, it's not. Because if it was, we'd never be forgiven. But what He was reminding us of is that as often as we pray that prayer, "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us," to reflect on the fact that we are receiving God's forgiveness, and so in turn, we are giving that forgiveness. We are receiving that free gift, despite who we are, despite what we deserve. A lot of people, they hold on to those things because they think that the other person won't get what they deserve. That somehow they won't get their up and comings. The Lord promises us, Deuteronomy chapter 32, "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord," King James, "and recompense. For the Lord will vindicate His people and have compassion on His servants." The Lord promises to vindicate us. He promises that all things are in His control, that He will take care of those who have done wrong to us. Now notice, the Lord doesn't say He'll give them what they deserve. Because again, thank the Lord that He doesn't give us what we deserve. Truly, if we got what we deserve, each and every one of us would die eternal death in hell. If we got what we deserve, we would not receive forgiveness. But instead of getting what we deserve, we are given what Christ deserved, forgiveness for our sins. Because Jesus took on every single one of our sins. God didn't merely lose our sins and because He was forgetful, but He wrote off our sins, every single one of them on Jesus. Jesus went to the cross and He bore every one of our sins. He bore every one of our pains so that we could hear, "I forgive you." Those are the words our Lord and Father speaks to us now. "I forgive you." Not because of what you have done, not because you deserve it, but because of what my Son has done, what Jesus did for us. And He showed great strength in doing so, didn't He? I'd like to take you back to that Gethsemane. The disciples and Jesus, they'd enjoyed that Passover meal, hadn't they? Even with Judas the betrayer there, they enjoyed the meal together, the time of fellowship. After the meal, they went out. Just Peter, James, and John, and Jesus went out together to Gethsemane. Peter, James, and John, Jesus told them to stop and wait. "Pray for me," He said. But Jesus went further. He went further, and Luke tells us in Scripture that Jesus prayed with great anguish. In fact, he prayed with such great anguish that sweat like drops of blood ran down his face and ran down his body, that he wrestled so much so with the decision that his body was sweating profusely as he begged the Father, "If this cup should pass, let it pass from me. But not my will, but thy will." See, Jesus showed such great strength because he put, instead of his wants, his desires, instead of putting those first, he put us first. He put our needs first. And that's where the forgiving spirit begins, is when we are humbled, realizing how Jesus gave up everything for us. When we are humbled, when we know that the words that are spoken, "I forgive you," are not mere empty words, but those are the words that are given to us because of Jesus. And that's where our forgiveness begins. When we humble our hearts before the Lord, when we stop putting our own desires for revenge, our own desires for getting what others deserve first, and instead put Christ first, instead put his love first, and instead put his forgiveness first. Now I know that this is asking a lot. I know that this is something that not one of us can do on our own, that we will struggle with our whole lives long. But it's something that when we bring it to the Holy Spirit, when we bring it to the Lord in heaven, he will give us strength. And sometimes you'll be able to forgive with the strength of the Spirit immediately, but sometimes you're going to have to go to the Lord day in and day out. You might even have to go more than once a day asking the Lord to give you strength to forgive another person for what they have done to you. But in that labor, in that time of prayer, you'll grow closer to the Lord. You'll see and reflect on how great his grace is for us. His promise that because we are forgiven, we shall be his children forever with him in heaven. May the Lord fill your hearts with his rich grace. And may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard and keep your hearts and minds. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.